Okay, so Grishma, you joined late. I know we are doing a task. What we have to do, I hope you understood, right? You just have to tell me which color the, what is the color of the ink of these words? Can you try?
Okay.
Yeah, start.
Green, red, blue, green, blue, yellow, red, green, yellow, green, blue, blue, blue. Green, red, yellow, red, red, yellow, blue, green, blue, red, yellow.
Okay, very good. Who would be next? Aishwarya?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Green, red, blue, green, blue, yellow, red, green, yellow, green, blue, 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 green, yellow. Red, red, blue, yellow, blue, green, blue, red, yellow.
Okay, Amal, try.
Green, red, blue, green, blue, yellow, red, green, yellow, green, blue, 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 green, red, yellow, red, red, yellow, blue,
green, then
blue,
eh?
Red, yellow.
Okay, Ashish, are you there? I can't see him. Ashish.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, continue. Start the task.
Green, red, blue, green, blue, yellow, red, green, yellow, green, blue, 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 green, red, red, yellow, red, red, yellow, green, blue, yellow, blue, red.
Okay, thank God, Ashish, I at least heard your sound. Otherwise, I would be calling Ashish. Are you there? Ashish, are you there? Very good, Ashish. Then, who's next? Meghna.
Green, red, blue, green, blue, yellow, red, green, yellow, green, blue, 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 green, red, yellow, red, red, yellow, blue, green, blue, red, yellow.
Okay, fine. Everybody done, right? Yes. Did you notice one thing? That blue, blue, blue thing was common for everybody. You didn't find any difficulty there. Blue, blue, blue. I could hear blue, blue, blue from everyone. Okay. So this is a particular task. How many of you have been practicing this thing since I showed this? How many have been trying to read? Aishwarya, did you try reading it? Yes, then? Meghna, did you try? While the others were doing the task, did anybody try reading it? Because Aishwarya and all, you had a little bit ease than the first person who was doing the task. So this task is or the effect that you observed or experienced is known as Stroop effect in psychology. What happens is we have been set our minds, or we have been automaticized. The reading process is an automatic process in us. That is why we are so much forced to read that particular word than noticing the color. Reading has become an automatic process for us. That is why you are facing difficulty in giving the name of the color than reading it. Yes, reading is pretty easier, right? Like you are finding it more easier to read the word green than telling the color of that word, color of the ink. There is something known as Stroop effect in psychology. We'll probably learn that in attention chapter. Okay, this was just a fun task. So and it is one of the psychological test. It is one of the neurobiological tests that we do. So something related to our topic, but not much related. So going back to our reliability, validity, blah blah blah. Yeah, we were studying about reliability. We studied the two types, that is test, retest reliability and the split half reliability. Then, yeah, now we are going to see about validity, the second thing. So three things were validity, reliability, as well as norms. We'll see what validity is. After finishing these two topics, we'll move on to a very interesting thing, that is types of tests. We'll see what all types of tests are there in psychology. Now, validity, yes, coming back to this point, validity refers to how accurately a method measures what it is intended to measure. Validity refers to the question, does the test measure what it claims to measure? Suppose if I am designing or constructing a test that measures anxiety, then the test has to measure anxiety. Validity is as simple as that. If you are designing a test to measure intelligence, then the test should measure intelligence. And you don't have the types of validity to learn. There are too many numbers of types of validity, which is very complicated to understand. I mean, at your particular stage, because you are just introduced to psychology. So as of now, we don't need the types. We just understand the concept. Validity means, does the thing measure what it claims to measure or what it is designed to measure? That's all. That's all about validity. For example, if you have constructed a test of mathematics achievement, whether the test is measuring mathematical achievement or, for example, language proficiency, which means you have designed a test to understand how good is a person in doing mathematical problems or in doing calculations. You have designed a test to know how good this particular person or the person whom we are testing is good in maths. And does the test measure this particular variable, which is mathematical proficiency, or not? If it measures it accurately, then that test is valid in nature. It has validity. Or if it doesn't measure maths, or it measures some other aptitude or attitude of the person or some other variable, then we can't say that it is valid. Understood? Just learn that statement. Validity refers to how accurately a method measures what it is intended to measure. What it is designed to measure, it has to measure. If it measures it, then it is valid. Simple, right? That's it. Okay, that's about validity. Now, regarding norms. A test becomes a standardized test when norms are developed for the test. So usually we say, if we have norms regarding particular age or particular gender or based on particular locality, then if we have developed norms based on that, then we say that the test is standardized in this particular age. The test is standardized for children. The test is standardized in India. The test is standardized for Americans. Like that. We'll see what norms are. Norm is the normal or average performance of the group. So if I am trying to find the intelligence of our class, of the students of our class, then I will take the IQ scores of each of you. And I will calculate an average of that. So I have an average value of the intelligence scores of your particular class, your particular group. And if I have to test the the intelligence of a particular person or a single person. Say I'm measuring the intelligence, I'm administering an intelligence test for Elvina. And I will get a score. I will write down her intelligence score. And then what I do, I will compare her particular score with that of the group. And I'll compare it and I'll decide if she has got a low score or a high score or an average score. Understood. So these norms are for a comparison purpose. To compare, the norm will usually be the average performance of the group in which we are doing the test. And for comparing the score of the particular participant, what we do is we take these norms and we compare the individual score with these average scores, which are called norms, and then we interpret the result. We decide if it is high or low or average or borderline or whatever. Understood? So the norms are particularly the normal or average performance of the group. Now, the test is administered on a large number of students. Their average performance standards are set based on their age, sex, place of residence, etc. And this helps us in comparing the performance of an individual student with others of the same group. It also helps in interpreting individual scores obtained on a test. Yeah, it helps in the interpretation process. That is, we get an IQ score, but we don't know what to do with it, right? There is just a final score and we can't interpret it based on anything. So we take the normal or average score of the group and then we compare it with others. So we say according to the norms, usually in psychological tests, we already have earlier developed norms. We have norm tables. Suppose again, coming back to your example regarding intelligence test, we have scales. We already have the range values from this score to this score. We have average intelligence. From this score to this score, we have borderline intelligence. From this score to this score, we have high intelligence. Those were developed by the scientists or by the researchers or the psychologists who developed this particular intelligence test. They already tested this in a particular age range, and then they have developed norms already. So we can compare easily. We don't have to create or develop the norms again. We don't have to administer it to a group of people, find the average, and then again compare. We already have already developed norms for most of the standardized test. Understood? That's what happens in norms. So the three things that we learned were the reliability, validity, and also the norms. So after all this is done, so after the norms are developed, then only we can say that the test is standardized in nature. Understood? So when we started learning about psychological tests, we learned that it has to be objective as well as standardized. For objectivity, for ensuring objectivity, we saw different methods about the item, the wording, the instructions, the administration, and all today. And then we have to take care of these three things: reliability, validity, and also norms to ensure the standardization procedure. Understood? That's basically about psychological testing. Now we move on to the types of tests. You have class till 5:40, right? Okay. Yes, types of tests, they are quite interesting, not so dull like the other concepts. Types of tests, we have three classifications basically. Based on the language, we classify test. Based on mode of administration, we classify test. We also classify them based on the difficulty level. Okay, so we'll see the first section, that is based on language. Where is it? Okay, depending upon language, we have three types or three kinds of tests. Write down, they are verbal tests, non-verbal tests, and also performance tests. Verbal test, you can know it from the name itself. They are the tests in which literacy is required because the items have to be written in some language. That is, which require the reading skills or writing skills and such things. Something that involves language or any test that involves language is known as a verbal test. So for example, the questionnaires that we have, the participant who is getting the questionnaire, he or she has to know how to read it, right? then only or he or she has to know the language in which the questions are written. Then only he or she can give a response to that. For that we require literacy, which means the language skills. That is why it is called a verbal test. Now what are non-verbal tests? Tests in which items are made of symbols or pictures. Here they don't need language proficiency. They don't need to know the languages. So even in tribal people who don't know English or who don't know Malayalam or Hindi, we can administer these non-verbal tests. They make use of symbols or pictures. Okay, they just need to interpret the symbols or pictures. Then we have performance test. Performance test means test requiring movement of objects from their respective places in a particular order. I hope you all are familiar with the building blocks thing. Yes, building blocks.
Yes,
we make different patterns, different objects with the small blocks. Then we have the puzzles, the jigsaw puzzles. All those are some form of performance test. There we have to move objects from their respective places to some other place to in some other order to complete doing that test. Okay, in psychology also we have such puzzle questions or the puzzle tasks. I'll show you a picture. Yes. Can you see it? Is it clear? Yes. So the picture on the left side is about a questionnaire. So this would probably come under which section? Which test?
Verbal test.
Verbal test. Okay. And the other one, the on the top right corner, you have a thing that is made up of pictures or symbols, and that would probably come under the non-verbal test. Okay, and here you can see the kid playing with that, and that is something we have regarding the intelligence test. In course block test and all, we have this particular type of blocks. There we have pattern cards. We have different cards in which patterns are given. And what the participant has to do is they have to make use of these blocks. They have to move it in certain order and manner and then create or recreate the pattern given in the pattern cards. Understood. So that would fall under which category, Meghna?
Performance.
Performance test. So understood the three tests based on language? Yes. Amal, did you understand? Amal is busy with something else, I think. No? No? There is a smile on your face. Yes, you are doing something else. Listen in the class, okay? Yes. Then that was about depending on the language, we classify tests into verbal, non-verbal and performance test. Then depending upon the mode of administration, we have individual test as well as group test. We'll see what individual tests are. Individual test. Test administered by the researcher to one person at a time. The researcher might administer the test face to face and remain seated before the test taker and notes down the responses. They may be time consuming but are important ways of getting responses from children and from those who do not know the language. It's simple, the individual and group test. In individual test, the researcher or the, I can't call it an experimenter, the person who is conducting the study, he or she can sit in front of the participant. He or she can ask the questions directly. Then only to one person, this particular test is being done at a time. Only to an individual, only to a particular individual, the test is being done. When we do a group test, only the one researcher will be there and so many participants will be there. So many group of people will be there who are being tested at a single time. In individual test, only one person is tested at a time. Whereas in group test, there'll be so many participants being tested at a single time. Understood the difference? Yes. Okay. So here they can do the individual test. They can do a face-to-face test and the we can get the responses at that particular time itself, and the single participant gets more attention from the researcher also. But the thing is, if we have to conduct the research among 30 participants, then we have to, I mean, the researcher has to sit with each participant for a couple of time. So it's very time consuming. That is one disadvantage of individual test to that of group test. But it is advantageous in different other matters. How it is in important ways of getting responses from children and from those who do not know the language. So in terms of children, if we get some 5-year-olds to a room and we give them some task to do, or we give them some test to do, will we get enough responses? They'd be sitting and playing there, right? With all those tools and experiments, they'd probably be throwing things at each other, and we'll have to be responsible for that too, finally. So what we do is, we take each child, each 5-year-old to the place where we are conducting the research, and we ask them questions or we make them do activities. Such things can be done, and that is an individual test. When we do for single participant, it is an individual test. So in contrast to that, the group test, the other test administered to a large number of people at the same time. Here the instructions about answering the items are written on the test, which the test taker reads and answers the questions accordingly. This is not always necessary, but what is generally done is the researcher can give a general instruction to the participants, to the entire group, and then they can read the instructions on the booklet that they get or on the task that they get. They are much easier to administer and also less time consuming as compared to individual tests. Now, however, there are chances that the respondent might give fake responses. So when we do test on a group of people, each person gets less attention, right? So they might give fake responses during that time. And in individual tests, what they do, we give more attention to a single person at a single time. So they might be giving less fake responses as compared to group test. Okay, so that is about the types of tests depending upon the mode of administration. They are individual test as well as group test. Yes, so let me ask you, the exam that you write, is it a group test or an individual test?
Individual,
is it?
Group test.
How?
Everyone
is writing the same. Yes, it is a group test, Raina. Because the invigilator comes in the morning, gives a general instruction that you have to do this, you have to switch on your videos, you have to ensure that your connectivity is okay, you have to do this, you have to do that, and the general instructions are done. And then each of you get a question paper in which instructions are given. This is for 2 marks, describe in 2 words, describe in 100 words, 300 words. Such instructions you read and you write the exam, right? Yes, Raina? Yes. So that would probably be a group test. Now, when each one of you is called for Viva, that would be an individual test. Understood? Each one of you would be getting a chance to attend a Viva examination. That would be an individual test. Understood? See the picture here. You see that? On the left side, on the lower part, we have an individual test being conducted. There is only a single participant and a single researcher, and the test is being administered there. While on the other part, we have a group of people. We have a group of participants who is being tested. And this is a picture of an examination going on. So that is an example of a group test. Understood? Yes. Now, depending upon the difficulty level, that is the third part. So the first one was depending upon the language. We have verbal, nonverbal, and performance test. Then depending on the what? Depending on the mode of administration, we have individual as well as group test. And the last one is, depending upon the difficulty level, we have speed test and power test. They are also very simple to learn. In speed test, they are the tests in which there is a time limit within which the test taker is required to answer all the items. Here, all the items are of the same degree of difficulty. For example, have you heard about just a minute competition, JAM?
Yes.
Yeah. What is it, Aishwarya?
Can you have to speak about a topic for 1 minute. The topic would be given at that moment.
Okay. So that is based on a time limit. In 1 minute, you have to complete the task. That is, you have to start giving an introduction. You have to talk about the content and you have to conclude. You have to do all this within this 1 minute. Understood. So that would probably be a speed test. You are supposed to do a task. You have to complete an activity and the difficulty level is almost the same there, right? You have option to complete the task within 1 minute and there is no other difficulty level. That is, after 30 seconds, they are not asking you to talk about another topic. You just have the same degree of difficulty there. But the thing is, you have to complete the task within a time frame, within a time limit. So those tasks or those type of tests are known as speed tests. And power test would be then the opposite of it. That is, there is no time limit for the power test. Test that assess the underlying ability or power of the individuals by allowing them sufficient time. That is, these tests do not have any time limit. Such tests are known as power tests. They don't have time limit, that you have to note. Then they assess or they try to measure the abilities of the person, the power of the person to complete the task. Okay. And here the items are generally arranged in an increasing order of difficulty. Here we did the Stroop task, right? And I give you this particular list. And suppose I give you a list. How many words does this picture has have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 words are?
24.
Okay, so 24 words in this. And next I give a list of say 36. And then I give a list of 42 words. So your task would be to complete this list, the 36 worded list, the 42 worded list, and 56 worded list, 63 worded list. Similarly, I'll arrange it in such an order, from increasing in an increasing order. Okay, just imagine I do it like that. So what happens, that would become a power test. I don't give you a time limit. You can complete it as and when you want it, but you have to finish it in an increasing order of difficulty. There is no time limit, but you have to do it in that particular increasing order. And what happens is, with these tasks, suppose there is some other, you saw that pattern, right? In the performance test, the pattern test, I told about the blocks thing. In that also, we have certain patterns in increasing difficulties. So the first pattern would be very simple, and the sixth or seventh or eighth one would be very difficult in nature. So if the person cannot do the sixth or the fifth task, then he would find the seventh or ninth task more difficult, right? So it is arranged in an increasing order of difficulty. So probably when this person cannot do the fifth task, then he cannot do the sixth or the seventh task again. So there the final measure or the ability of the person would be finally 5. Only he can do only 5 tasks, or he can do only 4 tasks before that. He can complete only till 4. So his score would be 4 then. Understood. That is regarding power test. So again, the speed test has a time limit. The power test does not have a time limit. And in speed test, they are required to complete the task within the particular time frame, but here they don't have a time frame, but they should complete the task in increasing order of difficulty. That's the only thing. Okay, that's all about our psychological testing. The topic is over. We learned about different things that is being measured in a psychological test. We saw the definition. We saw the about objectivity, how objectivity can be ensured. Then regarding test construction, we have to take care of so many things. And after we have so many steps in that, after analysis of items, after we write down the items, after we analyze the items, we have three things to be noted. They are reliability, validity, and norms. And we saw reliability, validity, and norms. Then we saw the types of test. Based on language, we have three. Then based on the administration, mode of administration, we have two. And based on the other thing, what was it? What was it?
Difficulty level.
Difficulty level. We have how many, Elvina?
Two types of difficulty level.
Which are they?
Speed test and power test.
Okay. Understood? All these? Okay, now tomorrow we'll start with case study. Okay, so psychological testing was another method. Okay, just like observation method, experimental method, and the survey method, psychological testing is yet another method. And we have one more method to study, which is case study. And we finish the methods tomorrow. Yes? Okay, thank you then.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.